So now I have the pleasure to introduce Walter Tiring. Well, of course, Walter Tiring does not need an introduction here. And I will, however, just make a very brief list here of some of the stations of his life. And in fact, you can read about his life in his books. Very interesting life, very interesting biography. His promotion to was here in Vienna in 1949. Then there were several stations as a postdoc in many countries. In fact, I remember Helga once told me that she had moved, I think, about 10 times or so, or even more in during this Wanderjahre. But I just mentioned here Dublin with Schrödinger, whom Walter, of course, knew very well before, because Schrödinger was a good friend also of his father, Hans. Now Dublin, Glasgow, Göttingen, the ETH, where he was assistant of Wolfgang Pauli, then Bern, then the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton, in 1953-54, where he met Albert Einstein. Then the MIT, University of Washington in Seattle. And since 1959, he's professor here in Vienna and emeritiert since 1997. He was director of the theory group of CERN from 1968 to 71. And 1993, he was one of the founding fathers of this the institute. He was also the first president of the International Association of Mathematical Physics. I would like to mention just also one thing, because I think Walter is an extremely good and interesting example of development of a first-rate theoretical physicist to a mathematical physicist. I have once made this comparison, which some of you know. There are people who say that the best Heldentenöre are people who started their career as baritones, Lawrence Melchior being a prime example of that. And Walter Tiring started his career, so to say, as a baritone in as an excellent theoretical physicist, but then there came this transition to a Helden tenor of mathematical physics after about 10 years, and he has been really a leading figure in that area since then. Now, among his many distinctions and the Ehrendoktor, I would just like to mention the Erwin Schrödinger Prize of the Austrian Academy of Sciences in 69, the Max Planck Medal in 78, the Österreichisches Ehrenzeichen für Wissenschaft und Kunst in 93, and the Henri Poincaré Prize for Mathematical Physics, awarded by the International Association of Mathematical Physics. He was one of the first prize winners when this was awarded. So, I now give the word to Walter, and we look very much towards hearing your reminiscences of Erwin Schrödinger.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this kind introduction. This will be a totally different lecture. There will be no PowerPoint, no transparencies, even no formulas. But then you may wonder why do I need this book? Well, these are poems. And why do I need this sheet? This is an unpublished poem of Schrödinger's contained only in a letter. So I will try to paint a picture of this man from my memories, which date from the year 1937, when I met first Schrödinger. And ever since I had met him on and off, and so there are many memories which I have, personal and scientific and anecdotal. Anecdotals I will not bring so many because it's clear about such a man with so many faces. There are many anecdotes and what is true and is there another question. So I will mainly rely on my own memories. And but to bring some order in this chaos, I will try to find a temporal order. So let me start with the year 37. Schrödinger at that time was professor in Graz, and he came to visit my father in Vienna in early summer. And what I really remember is what I was doing when I accompanied them for what they liked to do at that time, mainly to go swimming in the Danube. We went swimming to the Kuchelau, this was a favorite place. And Schrödinger, well, he was 50 years at that time, was still sportive enough to go there, although there were no facilities. It just changed and behind the bushes, and then went into the Danube swimming. And while the Danube is a kind of cold river, it has about 18 degrees or so, and it has rather strong currents, up to 10 meters per second. So to go swimming there is a kind of sportive enterprise, but he did it. So, well, in fact, we even did more. Namely, at that time, there were these towing boats which towed cargo ships upward, and the front wave was rather strong. And so we tried to jump into the water in such a way that we could reach the front wave when it was still very high, perhaps 2 meters or so, and to dive through it, which made this was a nice sport. Now, this Schrödinger didn't want to do, so he was sportive to some extent, but he didn't want to overdo it. But this kind of relaxed atmosphere was treacherous because both my father and my Schrödinger knew that the political situation was very dangerous. And in fact, the next year came the Anschluss, and there Schrödinger made one of his great mistakes. He made a declaration of solidarity with the Nazi regime. It didn't do him any good because they wanted to confiscate his passport, and so his overnight he went away. But one should not perhaps be too harsh to condemn him because of that, because one has to keep in mind that he was pushed around up to this time by the political forces, and he even from Berlin he went away because of the Nazis, although he had sort of the deep short for a theoretical physicist, namely the successor of Max Planck. And so finally he was in Graz and he didn't want to be pushed around once more, but nevertheless, it happened. So then, of course, during the war years, there was a long gap where I couldn't see Schrödinger. And when I had my doctor's degree, I had a medical paper on virus sensing and the person went, how do we know that E is MC squared is correct? And he was sort of pleasantly impressed by my inquisitive mind and said he can offer me a scholarship in Dublin, which of course for me was the chance of my lifetime after the doctor's degree to go to Schrödinger. Of course, now it sounds trivial to go from Vienna to Dublin to take a jet plane, and in 1.5 hours you are there. At that time, the traveling was something totally different. First of all, no planes, you had that. Only have to take the trains, which were very slow, and at every border you have to show the passport and the visa. And the visa question was even more difficult because to go to Ireland needed a visa through England, a transit visa to England. And but to get the transit visa, I first had to get a visa for Ireland, so it was very complicated. And in addition, the Austrian citizens were legally forbidden to have any foreign money, so there was money forthcoming only once I was in Ireland. So these were some difficulties, and after a travel of several days, I arrived in Dublin. And then how do you find Schrödinger in Dublin? Well, it wasn't so easy because he didn't live in Dublin. He lived in a minor suburb of Dublin, Clontarf. It took us then by bicycle to go for half an hour, so it's a little bit outside. But still, I succeeded in finding him. And he was really very charming and friendly and invited me to live with them for the first time until I found some accommodation. And he really made everything to make my stay as pleasant as possible. In fact, they lived quite modestly. They didn't have a permanent maid, and so Schrödinger was afterwards washing the dishes. And of course, I felt I should help him, but he said, no, don't worry, I'll do that. So, his life wasn't quite that simple in Dublin, because unfortunately, his wife suffered from depressions. And she had, from time to time, go to the hospital where they treated her at that time with this terrible method of electroshocks, which is something very brutal. And Schrödinger had to run the whole place by himself. So he just asked me to bring some laundry to the cleaners or so. But what is always said that he had always many girlfriends, and they were notoriously absent in this moment where he really needed some help. And so I tried to be as useful to him as possible, even if it was against my convictions, because he was a notorious chain smoker. And once he found out in the weekend that he ran out of tobacco. And so this was for him a catastrophe. And so he asked me whether I could cycle into town and get some tobacco for him. Now, as I said, it was against my convictions, being a militant anti-smoker, but nevertheless, he I felt I had to do it, so I did it, and this weekend was saved for Schrödinger.
Now, Schrödinger's easygoing way was reflected in the spirit of the institute, where they had some scholars, a worldwide selection, Indian and American and Australians. And Schrödinger arrived around 11 o'clock in the morning, and then we had tea. And the tea served, of course, only as a possibility to meet people and to discuss all sorts of things. And among them also scientific issues. But Schrödinger somehow was hesitant to talk about what he was doing himself at this moment. He just would sort of discuss on what other people were doing or trivialities, and you could sort of see how he thought. But I think it was one of his defects that he did not say that really he was dealing with some hard subjects. I will soon come to that. But the way he was thinking made it clear that he was a physicist. He was thinking in terms of physics and not in terms of mathematics. For instance, when one writes the Schrödinger equation in the usual way in polar coordinates, and then there's this term L times L plus 1 divided by R squared, he said, well, that's obviously the centrifugal force. He didn't say that if you go to polar coordinates, you have to calculate some connection forms, and the connection forms come out of that. There's this coefficient, but he was thinking in terms of what is the mathematical meaning, what is the physical meaning of this term. Nevertheless, there were some instances when the physical intuition didn't guide properly. Let me take an example, namely quantum field theory. He somehow had some aversion against quantum field theory, and he explained it why. The reason, he said, because the number of states or orthogonal states is not enumerable. And the argument he gave is a well-known argument. It's very simple. If you just think in terms of occupation of states, an infinite number of states, and even if you fermion states, where you have fewer states, there's the possibility of the state being occupied or unoccupied, and so to specify the state, you have to give a infinite sequence of, say, zeros or ones. And this, of course, is the same as all real numbers in the binary system. And therefore, the power of states is equal to the power of the continuum. And he said this doesn't make any sense, because to verify, measure such a state, you need a non-enumerable number of measurements. And a non-enumerable number of measurements doesn't make any sense. Now, he did not realize that this question had been clarified by von Neumann, Murray and von Neumann, already a little early in the early 40s. When I was in Dublin, this was 49 to 50. And this had been clarified by Murray and von Neumann, namely that in this infinite tensor product, the
then indeed the round innumerable number of states, but nevertheless the representation of the observables is always in innumerable subspaces. So this difficulty of Schrödinger does not arise. But he, this level of mathematics he did not reach. And another way of observing this mathematical skill was he gave some lectures, which he then collected into little books, and they were published by the Cambridge University Press. And I was fortunate to be present in two of these lecture series, in fact. And one was space and time structure, and the other was expanding universes. Now, in space and time structure, he gave some very, it was a general relativity, and he gave a very nice exposition of the subject, however, using the conventional Levi-Civita formalism with the connections, with the Christoffel symbols, and so on. Strangely enough, the more effective formulation of Élie Cartan was not mentioned by him. I don't know whether it was not known to him. Of course, it was in English-speaking or in German-speaking countries. It was not so well known because he published in French, and French was not a language which was so common among physicists. But he had actually the ingredients for all that he had prepared. And in his lectures, he made the point that for totally anti-symmetric covariant vectors, you could define a differential operation without referring to the metric, which is sort of one of the keystones of the Cartan formulation. But nevertheless, he didn't mention Cartan at all and didn't use that. Strangely enough, Cartan was for a long time unknown to the physicists. Apparently, there was a discussion between, an exchange of letters between Einstein and Cartan, which was friendly, but not one of them tried to understand the others. They were sort of had no effect. The reason may have been that for Cartan, these were visions. He never worked out the details. The details were worked out later on by people from the Bobrovsky school, like Giovanni, but this was not around at that time, and so perhaps because this was not so explicitly done, it did not become so popular. This was one of the little books which he then published, Space and Time Structure, which I think is still a good introduction even today. The expanding universes is essentially all about the Sitter universe, and it brings you the different aspects of the Sitter universe in different coordinate systems, which is a very sort of amazing for the layman, or let's say the beginner, to see that this expanding universe can be also in other coordinates a static universe, doesn't expand just because it's sort of the coordinates which run along with the expansion, and it has many properties. However,
he did not mention that he was finding something which then later can be identified as the Hawking radiation. He had written a paper on the Dirac equation in the City Universe, and he found that the positive and negative frequencies in the course of times get mixed. And he even realized that this means there's a particle creation. But this is where the story ends. It is, of course, the Hawking radiation at the City Universe, which we had discovered, but he didn't pursue this any further. It is strange that he had, in fact, many missed occasions, partly because he didn't have also enough appropriate collaborators to follow up his ideas or recognize the importance of his ideas. There was a mathematician, John Singh, who was a very good mathematician, but mathematics only in the classical sense. He had one disadvantage: he didn't speak Gurbaki. And so, if you express something in modern terminology, he not only didn't understand, he washed it away, he doesn't want anything, has anything to do with that. And nevertheless, he had the lectures of Schrödinger's space and time structure. He made a remark that it would be nice if all these things could be transformed into at least existence and uniqueness theorems of the solutions of the Einstein's equation. They were notoriously absent, and also Schrödinger had nothing to offer on that. This was not Schrödinger's fault, it was the zeitgeist at that time, that people didn't worry about existence and uniqueness of solutions. And Singh said that it will take about 50 years until this will be clarified, and I think this was a pretty good guess. It took about 50 years until this was clarified. Well, the most famous of his little books on public lectures was the What is Life, which took place a little earlier in 1953. Somehow he had never mentioned it afterwards, and also strangely enough, it certainly was one of the most influential books which sort of got all this molecular biology going. Nevertheless, there were some harsh criticisms about it. In fact, I don't know that the criticism were unduly harsh. I don't know why, but it seems that he had some enemies. They complained that Schrödinger talked all the time about the entropy and wanted to illustrate the things with the entropy, but the entropy is irrelevant for living beings. That's the free energy which counts, because they are always in contact with the environment. And so one should concentrate on the free energy. Well, there's something to be said for that. After all, our diet is more out for energy rather than for entropy, or rather we eat sausages and not diamonds.
But I think from the point of view of a representation, it is quite legitimate to talk about the entropy. And also it was said
there was nothing new in what Schrödinger said. Now, it is true, none of his public lectures was anything new. It was just that he represented things in such a way that he got people interested in the subject. And I think there's a great merit into that. And in fact, Crick and Watson admitted that they had been sort of initiated by Schrödinger to move into this field. And so this was a great merit for Schrödinger. Another missed occasion, which he didn't talk about anymore, was that he also was almost on the verge of discovering supersymmetry, because he was interested in factorizing Hamiltonians, to write the Hamiltonian as an object times its conjugate, which is the sort of the standard way of supersymmetry. Now he made some interesting contributions to that, but he didn't know that this had something with Bose and statistics, and Einstein-Fermi statistics to do. Another thing which he anticipated, and he didn't talk about it to us, apparently he talks to nobody about it, so it was unknown, was that he anticipated the Higgs mechanism for creating the mass of a H particle. He wrote this in this small letter in Nature, and he observed that if you take purely classically a complex scalar field and you couple it to the electromagnetic field, then what you get is, well, everybody knows it today, the electromagnetic field assumes a mass. He didn't have anything which depends on the size of the scalar fields. He didn't have anything to fix that, so he didn't have this Higgs mechanism. But nevertheless, he had a good example for a system where, although it's gauge invariant, the gauge particle gets a mass. And this is something where he just then always sort of jokingly talked about the holy gauge invariance, which he doesn't believe in, but he never sort of pressed this example. So I think Higgs and Kibler and so did it quite independently of Schrödinger. So these were my impressions in the year in Dublin. Then I met him in 55, and when he came to the PISA conference, where he discussed the mass of the photon, which was one of his main occupations in his old time. And as I said before, his argument was rather simple, namely that if there were a mass and there were some longitudinal modes, then the nature of the black body radiation would change by a factor to thirds or so. And he finally saw that out, namely if the mass goes to zero, the longitudinal modes sort of get less and less interaction and they sort of slowly die out to nothing. But still, it's an amusing fact that nobody was interested in that. So although you would say that this is certainly a fundamental question, like now the question whether neutrino have a mass or not, this is also a fundamental question.
And then we are already approaching the time that Schrödinger returns to Vienna. And this was a long process
right after the war, Schrödinger was opposed already in 1946 that he wouldn't want to come back and assume the professorship in Vienna. But he was very, let's say, very careful and didn't want, under these political conditions at that time, go back. And I think this is was very justified because, I mean, he had been pushed around in his life so often, and he didn't want to go into a city which was surrounded by the Russian occupation troops. And so only after Austria existed again in 1955, it was more successful, and eventually he wanted to come back. Now, apparently he had some great expectations, and maybe I will illustrate this expectations by a little poem which he wrote. I didn't say before, but he physics was only one of his occupations. Another occupation was poetry. In fact, even if he didn't write poetry, but if he wrote scientific papers, his style was always superb. And he told me how to do that. When I was writing a paper there, and he said, "Show it to me." And I showed it to him and said, "No, that's not good. No, you have to do it quite differently. You have to go to your room and lock the door, and you read it loudly, one sentence after the other, and after each sentence, you think a little bit whether this is really the best way you want to do it, or by reshuffling the sentence, perhaps you could make it a little clearer to get out what you want to say." And so apparently this is how he got to his style. And the poem I want to read is called Mid-September. Mitte-September. Wenn erst die Gleichen vorbei, kommt wieder Sonnenglanz. Leuchtender als eins im Mai, wirbelt der Blättertanz durch die Alleen. Bräutlicher neigen die überreichen Zweige sich zum Spiegel der Seen. Aber nein, nein, vorüber ist neues Grünen, vorüber die kurkühnen, furchtlosen Pläne. Nur mit geliehenen Fittichen sühnen wir müden Schwäne zum Nichtsein hinüber. So sagen andere. Glaub es nicht. Wandere mutig und frei durch all dieses Sterben. Nur den Vermessenen, Selbstvergessenen ist es Verderben. Uns schafft es neu. Schöner als einst im Mai wirbelt im Herbst des Glanz leuchtender Blättertanz. Nichts ist vorbei. Apparently, these were his hopes, and unfortunately, when he came, it was not September, it was November, and he had his health was so exhausted that he really didn't have the strength anymore to enjoy his life here in Vienna. Now, there are many facets of Schrödinger. In fact, originally he wanted to become a philosopher. He had an offer as a professor to Czernowitz, and he said that this is what he wanted to do, because in this provincial university, he could fulfill his duties by giving his lectures in physics, and this would leave him ample of time to pursue his philosophical ideas. Now, about religion, he was somewhat ambiguous. I never discussed this with him in detail, but anyway, he sometimes declared happily to be an atheist. On the other hand, he spent his whole life trying to develop a notion of God. And so it is difficult to position him somewhere. And there was once we had a controversy about religious instruction. This was in when in China Mao came to power, and at the party I said, I think it's rather bad there, because now even religious instruction is forbidden. And he said, is this really so bad? And I said, yes, because once religious freedom is suppressed, then freedom of thought will go away afterwards, rather soon enough. And in fact, in China, this is what happened. In fact, now the religious freedom exists to some extent, but the freedom of thought is very much suppressed. Now that he had some religious question follows from a poem which he wrote about his Indian philosophy, and I read it to you and you can judge how you tell it. It's Upanishad. Die ewige Frage, woher kommt, wohin geht dieses Ganze? Drin ein Punkt ich bin, und doch es ungeteilt und ganz und gar. Nichts außer mir, das erst nicht in mir war. Soll nach mir ohne mich das All bestehen? Wird es durch mich, werde ich mit ihm vergehen? War eine Zeit, als es mich noch nicht gab? Wird's weiter welten über jenem Grab, das sicher ist für jeden, wie nun das Licht sich so zu abertausend Farben bricht und eine Welt von Wundern rings aufbaut, im Baume grün, im hohen Himmel blaut, vor edler Frauen Lichtgestalt ins Knie dich zwingt mit siegender Gewalt. Ist wirklich Licht, was all und ganz erschafft, und nicht des eigenen Auges sehr Kraft, kann Schönheit sterben, hat sie Stund und Ort, einmal geboren, rollt sie ewig fort. Hier heut geschaut, wird es sie immer geben, sie wird in einem, deinem Auge beben. Wer solches weiß, dem weitet sich das Leben. So, I think this is my attempt to paint a picture of Ernest Schrödinger.
Very much appreciated, and we are extremely grateful for this moment. This is a historic moment, I find, to hear this reminiscences about Schrödinger. It was really wonderful. Thank you very much. I don't know if it's appropriate to have some questions or if somebody wants to make some comments. I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe we just go now for lunch.